Good evening to one and all present here. I am Aushmi of second year MHRM, DG Vaishnav College. Welcome you all for today's webinar on the topic Strategic Workforce Planning. Let us welcome our speaker for the day, Mr. Narayanan Ramachandran, Director, Global Talent Acquisition and Strategic Planning at Abdul Latif Jammu. Mr. Narayanan has over 2 decades of experience in human capital with global experience in strategic workforce planning, integrated supply chain, including global talent acquisition, HR analytics and intelligence, futuristic HR technology, and strategic business HR, architected digital strategy in HR, and creating digital assets. His area of expertise are strategic workforce planning, strategic HR business partnering, global talent acquisition strategy, HR analytics, social media strategist, lead technology and systems anchor for HR, policy and process formulations. Mr. Narayanan Ramachandran has completed his graduation in bachelor's and master's degree in chemistry from Madras Christian College. Adding to that, he has done MBBA, personal management and industrial relations from Symbiosis Institute of Management. Sir has also completed his studies in advanced HR analytics from Indian Institute of Management, Rohtak. He has worked as an associate director, recruiting in DXC Technology, Associate Director, Human Resources in Computer Science Corporation, Senior Director, Workforce Planning and Talent Acquisition at PwC India and Senior Manager, Recruitment. And these are just few of his experiences. It is an honor to have such an experienced resource person amidst us. We welcome you, sir. Now, I would like to introduce our Head of the Department of Human Resource Management, DG Vaishnav College, Dr. N.C. Martin. He is a highly experienced academician and has about 20 years of academic and administrative experience as professor, HOD, dean, and registrar. He did his postgraduate in labor management and PhD in labor laws from Tamil Nadu Institute of Labor Studies. He started his career as a lecturer from the same institutions. He held various positions in the arts and science colleges, engineering and media college. He held academic positions in various educational institutions such as Sri Chandraprabhu Jain College as Assistant Professor and HOD of MSW Department, SAMS College of Engineering and Technology as a Professor and HOD of MBA Department. He was also the Placement Officer for entire division of SAMS College of Engineering and Technology. During his tenure, he successfully placed engineering and management graduates in top-notch companies of manufacturing and service sectors across the country. He continued his career in St. Joseph's College of Arts and Science as a Dean of Academics and L.V. Prasad Film School, one of the best film schools in Asia, working as a registrar. He acted as a jury representing the Employers Federation of Southern India for the selection of companies for the best practices for the year 2018-2019. He has added a number of research papers and publications to his credit, and he is an expert in the subject of labor legislations and industrial relations. He has given centum results in various HR specialized subjects in the university examinations. We welcome you, sir. This meeting is recorded for educational purposes. In case of any doubts or questions, the participants can unmute themselves or type the questions in the chat box. Now I request Dr. N.C. Martin to speak a few words about the topic for the day.
Thank you, Martin, for the introduction. A very happy greeting to all present here. On behalf of management, Sri Ashok Kumar Mudraji, and our principal, Dr. S. Santosh Papu, I welcome all the participants, dear professors, students, and even some of our HR fraternities for this webinar. And a very special welcome to our resource person for the day, Mr. Narayanan Ramachandran, and Director of Global Talent Acquisition and Strategic Workforce Planning, Abdul Latif Jammu. And this is our 71st series of webinar. So start from the last pandemic. So it was been really successful because of the support from students as well as the faculty coordinator. So we are able to go in such a mileage. So coming to the topic, the strategic workforce planning. So this human resource planning, we can say it is a systematic and a strategic process through which aimed for evaluating the current state of an organization's human resources and also predicting its future workforce requirements. So it is also known as the workforce planning. So this planning helps an organization to recruit, retain, and optimize their deployment of people. So it depends on the size of the employee they require in order to meet their the business objectives. So integrating the human resource management strategies and the systems so will help the organization to achieve the missions, the strategies, and also will make the organization to succeed. So while meeting the needs of an employees and other stakeholders. Whereas the strategic HR planning, so it will help an organization to identify the current and the future human resource needs to achieve their end goals. So it links human resource management to the overall strategic plan of an organization. So to manage everything well in any organization, so we all know that the first and foremost thing is to plan everything properly. Since human assets are the very most important asset in any organization, and only based on the available human resource for the present and the future business, so the organization can taste the success not only in the current but also in the future. And this prospective approach towards human resource is called a strategic human resource planning. So if you see in the pandemic situation, so the organization has started to realize how important the human resources, and they started to respect the employees. So this situation has made every organization the importance of respecting the employees as human beings, and many organizations have given utmost caring for the employees in order to succeed in the long run. So moreover, the organization have also started strategizing what type of skills and the capabilities they need from employees for the organization to be success. But this pandemic has revealed that, so one should pay more attention to what the employees need and how fast they should meet the needs, and meeting those needs could also become the next big competitive for them in order to attract the top talents for the organization. So this focus has really elevated the influence of HR in many departments in the organization. So if you see every organization, so they have their own strategic human resource planning. So as it's a core element of HR management. So almost every organization, whether a small, medium, or a large size organization, so they have their own strategic plan, so that will enable them to meet their mission successfully. So on the whole, we can say that so no organization could be success unless they have an effective human resource planning to project the future workforce requirements and also to avoid the skill shortages or surplus workforce. So to achieve that, they should balance the required skills based on the need and their objectives. So therefore, the organization should have a workforce planning as a continuous process. So with a structure and a monitoring system so that they can enable them to have an adequate time to carry out their recruitment and also to train their employees and to meet their future requirements. So with this, I conclude and leave the session to the resource person. So that sir can, being a highly experienced person, so he could make the session very, very interesting with all his experience and insights. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you, Professor Martin. That's a that's a great context. I'm hoping you're able to hear me well.
Yes, sir.
Great. So that's a great context. Let me try and see if I can share my slides. I just prepared a small set of present slides that can probably serve as a placeholder. I'm not sure if you're able to see the slides. Are you?
No, sir. Not yet, sir.
Recording permission. Just give me 1 minute, please. Hey, I'll have to just leave the session and join back. It's asking for some permissions, so I have to quit and join back. Give me 30 seconds, I'll join back in.
Sure, sir.
Okay, can you see my slides now?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay, so I'll go back to my slides, put them in presentation modes. Let me know if you're able to see, continue to see me. Okay, so I'm sorry for the small technical challenges, right? So Professor Martin has had a great context, right, in terms of how strategic workforce planning helps across, right? Two very key statements to the entire work that we do in the corporates, right? What Professor Martin said. One, the workforce planning helps us ensure that the business objectives are met. So workforce planning is a translation of business goals. Whatever the company wants to achieve, what is the human resources that is required, or what is the capability that is required to achieve those business goals? That's the bridge that workforce planning tries to achieve, right? And the second thing is, like Professor talked about, in the same of pandemic, right, a lot of skills have changed, right? We've all got used to working remote. Roles that we thought we could never work from home or work from anywhere have been proven by the test of time for over the last 1.5-2 years that you could work from remote. So people's thought process have changed completely, right? Strategic workforce planning comes in those kind of areas, right? Translate business goals to human capital needs and continuously reevaluate the roles and the capabilities that is required for somebody to perform that role to have maximum success, right? That's where strategic workforce planning sits. So the next, I would say 20-25 minutes, I'll just take you through what practically happens in a large organization or in any organization. What do they do from a workforce planning standpoint, right? But before that, let me try and set a little bit more context. Now, when you go to any company, and you know, you'll have friends or colleagues or your own family members working in various organizations, whether they are in HR or in other things, right? The normal problems that they face, any company face, right? One, in today's world, there's just so much of attrition. People, you know, leave for whatever reasons. There's lower productivity, people are not motivated enough, they have low morale. And because of the attrition and all that stuff, there is burnout in employees, right? They don't like the work, maybe they're not suited for that work, or they're forced to give that work because of different reasons. And all of which has an impact on the business, has an impact on the brand as a company, right? If too many people are leaving in, if the people say, I don't like the place I'm working in, I don't like the job I'm working in, it's going to all have an impact on the organization. End of the day, the business is not going to be able to meet their goals, the company is not going to meet their goals. And if they're not able to meet their goals, they're going to grow and it'll have a cyclic effect, right? The employees don't feel they're part of a great organization and they're not giving their 100% to deliver. So it's a vicious cycle. Strategic workforce planning tries to solve all of this very scientifically, right? Try to put in a methodology in the madness, right? That we're trying to do. Try to put in a methodology across so that the methodology has a very scientific way of converting business goals into human capital needs. And ensure that the business goals and the human capital needs are continuously aligned. Now, I'm sure you also understand that the business goals will change. And again, going back to the pandemic, it's a classical example of how the business goals would have changed, right? What every company thought they wanted to do in January of 2020, or even in March of 2020, to what they're thinking now would be a North Pole, South Pole difference, right? The companies have changed, the strategies have changed. And for all of that, the human capital needs would have changed in an organization. What kind of people do they need to deliver to those goals, to those changed business goals? That will change. And how does, and or which organization or which methodology takes care of the changed business goals to the new needs of the human capital? That's what strategic workforce planning does, right? So workforce planning takes care of ensuring that there is a plan, there is a methodology, and there is a governance model. The execution of it is a subset of it, which most companies call it resource management or workforce management. So it's workforce planning is one part, workforce.
Sorry to disturb, the slide is not changing, sir.
No, I'm not changing the slide. I'm just on the same slide only. I've not even changed because the next one will get you into the concepts. Don't worry.
Sure.
No problem. Right. So just to repeat, strategic workforce planning ensures the strategy, the approach, the methodology, and the governance mechanism around this. Now, when it comes to execution, some companies, depending on the size and scale of organization, it's a separate sub-function called workforce management, where they execute the strategies, right? And workforce management works with different people. So if I go to the next slide now, what is workforce planning looking to do? It tries to bring in the right kind of people at the right place, at the right time, with the right skills, obviously, right? And in all of these things, the cost has to be optimum to the business. Otherwise, the business won't become profitable. And if it's not profitable, then it's not sustainable. So strategic workforce planning is trying to solve these problems, right? Solve the problems for the organizations where you try and get in all of these things. Imagine ideally, right, that you are getting a job that you like the most, that you love to do the most, that you are in the right place to do it, right? It's not uncomfortable for you. You are in the organization in the time that you have the flexibility to do the work and get the work done, right? And organization is ensuring that you have the right skills to do that job, and they're doing whatever to ensure that you have the right skills. It could be enablement, it could be teaching, it could be performance management, it could be anything, right? But the organization doing all of that. When you're as an individual in that kind of an environment, then your productivity and your contribution to the organization is going to be the highest possible peak, because you love what you do, you are in the right environment, you have a lot of energy to do, you are getting enabled to do what you want, and you are completely satisfied with the job, which means that as a human being, you tend to give the maximum, right? It's like at home, you don't need motivation to do a particular job, right? It's your home, you want to take care of your people, maybe your friends, brothers, sisters, siblings, whatever it is, right? You want to get that kind of a motivation levels in office, and that's what workforce planning aims to do, right? Here is the fundamental of workforce planning. I'm sure you're still able to see the slides, right? What we talked in the earlier slides, giving the right people at the right place, the right skills in the right time, in the cost, that's what workforce planning has to do. But what it does is it ensures that the sub-functions within HR, right? There are so many sub-functions. Like we talked about workforce management, right? Who manages the entire workforce of the organization? The workforce management team, the talent acquisition team, the learning and development team, right? In terms of giving learning and development inputs. There are large organizations with specific focus on organization development, which includes succession planning, leadership planning, high potential performance, and all that stuff, right? So you have organization development as part of it. Retention strategies. HR business partners in various organizations, their biggest idea is to retain the talent that they have. And in doing all of these things, they have to work with total rewards team to ensure that the employee of the organization is given the right rewards, the right recognition, the right platform, and the right cost for the skills. And they have to balance between what the employee think is right for the skills and value versus what the company sees as another business value. So workforce planning is able to integrate all of these functions together, right? And that's the beauty of this workforce planning tool, where it sits as an integrator. There are individual functions who work across, but it sits as an integrator, ensures that all these functions are working together to achieve a common business goal, which is ensure that you have the right human capital to deliver to your business needs, right? What does workforce planning other help? It has good visibility over skills. Now, skills is the most important raw material in any industry. You go to any industry. Now, I've worked for 22 years in IT industry, then I went to the consulting industry. Right now, I'm in a conglomerate of businesses where we have businesses from automotive to manufacturing to insurance to real estate to construction. There's a whole bunch of businesses that we have. No matter which industry are you in, for your business, you should have the people with the right skills. I mean, just having people doesn't help, right? You should have people with right skills. So you should have control over what skills do you have in the organization, and whether those skills are at the right level in terms of what the business needs, want to, and especially when it's changing right now. So you'll have good control over skills. You have a fair good capability to predict your future in terms of cost, right? What's you need to know that, hey,
sorry,
I have to have.
Sorry, extremely sorry to disturb you. So the slides are still not moving. So have you changed it?
Are you not in the slide which says strategic workforce planning fundamentals?
No, sir. We are in the introduction first slide, sir. So if you just click the second slide, we'll be able to see, sir. Yeah, now we are able to see, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Something is wrong with my. Okay, now you're able to see?
Yes, sir. We are able to see. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay. Strategic workforce planning. No problem. Sorry for that. Should have checked. So it enables good budgeting, right? One of the biggest things that companies wants to have is a predictability or a forecast of spend, right, from a human resource standpoint, right? So it gives you an opportunity to ensure that your budgetings are much better. And that's what most organizations ask for. If you go to any organization, you ask the leaders, they will tell you that more than 50% of their expense, right, in all the expenses they do, if it's a single item that contributes to more than 50% of the expense, it's labor cost. It's the cost that the human resources takes in terms of salaries, benefits, programs, whatever it is. So the single biggest cost factor for the company is human resources cost. And you need to, and for you to get your organization right in terms of profits and all that stuff, you should have great predictability towards budgeting what your human resource cost will be. Workforce planning enables that, right? It enables organization agility to respond in changing situations. And it's been proven in the last 1.5 years or 1.75 years, where organizations have struggled when they're not able to, when the lockdown was imposed almost across the globe, and some of the roles, some of the organizations were not able to cope up with that, right? We saw companies landing in trouble, people moving on, some people lost jobs because the organization didn't figure out how to get that job done, right? We heard all of those stories in various social media forums and all that stuff. But workforce planning ensures that you have the agility to respond in changing needs, either it's business needs or needs like a pandemic or whatever, right? It ensures that you're able to change across, right? And the planning, if you'll see in the next slide, you'll be able to see that it enables transition, right? When the business grows, when the world matures, the skill for the job changes, right? To a simple example of this is, look at your generation or two earlier, maybe two, three generations earlier. Look at how a marketing person did or how an HR person worked versus what a marketing person or an HR person works today, right? 20 years ago, there was nothing called social media. Right, there was nothing called branding on social media. There was nothing called marketing using social media sites. Today, in marketing, social media becomes the key most important factor to drive your brand, to drive your marketing strategies. Look at how the skills has changed for the same so-called marketing role. What was the marketing person doing 20 years ago? What is he doing now? Somebody has to ensure that the skills are getting transitioned, right? That there is a smooth transition of skills of the same person. It's not that when the skill changed, you will fire off this person and hire a new person, right? That's never sustainable for an organization. So how do you ensure that the skills of the employees are changing and it ensures career transitions across? That's what workforce planning does, right? And it allows the correct mix of employees. Mix could be in all the four things that you see on the right size, which means the pyramid and all that stuff, right? Scale, the right shape. Where should I get my people across? What kind of people should be sitting where, right? How much of individual contributors versus team members versus team leads versus whatever executive leadership that I need to have? And in what location I should be able to do. And again, that has been proven right in the last 1.5 years, right? Where should I have my people so that there is business continuity, they have ability to do the work, but then we can do it at much more cost benefit than anywhere else, right? Yeah, some of the fundamentals that workforce planning helps in an organization, and that's why it's important to do this. Typically, workforce planning starts when the year is starting or when just about the year is about to start. Typically, you need a much longer window, but at any point in time when you want to start, can you see my next slide?
So we're still on fundamentals one, strategic workforce.
Okay.
Yeah, sir. We are
not. Bring and get back in here every time. So I'm assuming you're able to see a structured approach would consider 3 to 5 years perspective to building workforce.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So when anybody asks the question saying, hey, how do I start workforce, strategic workforce planning? Where is my start point? The first thing that we'll have to look for is that you need to have a much longer horizon of thought. It's not about today and tomorrow. It's not about what talent do I need today, what talent do I need tomorrow, or whether it's one resource going in and how do I replace them and all that stuff. That's very transactional. That I'm not saying that's required. That is required, but that handles at a very different level, and I'll explain to you how it happens. But when you start off, when you're saying that, hey, I don't have a structured or a strategic workforce planning and I want to start it, the first thing that you look at is you go and understand the demand. before you understand fulfillment. That's why you'll see two squadrons here, right? You have workforce demand, workforce fulfillment. For you to understand the workforce demands, and like I said upfront, right? Strategic workforce planning tries to convert organizational goals into talent needs. So you have your organization goals. It could be anything, right? It could be as vague as I want to achieve a 10 billion revenue by some year. I want to have, let's say it's a global organization. I want to have 50% of my headcount in a low-cost country, which helped me have better cost perspective. Let's say it's a manufacturing company or an automotive company like that I'm working for. We are working towards, say, in a particular country, we want 35% market share for our products. It could be any of those business goals, right? You take those business goals, which is largely 3 to 5 years, right? It's not that you want to achieve them today or tomorrow. It's a 3-year business goal, right? Imagine you are a 2 billion organization today. You can't become a 10 billion organization tomorrow, right? It will take time. So it's a 3 to 5 year business goals that the CEO or the board prepares. Then you take the organization goals and transform into business strategy. Business strategies are year on year. Okay, if you want to achieve 10 billion by 2024, then let's say I am 2 billion today. What do I want to be by end of 2022? What do I want to be end of 2023? What do I want to be end of 2024? And at the end of that, you should be able to get onto your goals, right? So you have a year on year business strategy that meets your overall organization goals. And then you break it down. Okay, if I have to be, let's say I'm from 2 billion, I have to go to 3.5 billion. In by end of 2022, then you need to look at, okay, what are my areas of growth? Which business is going to grow to me? Which business will probably not grow? What are my opportunities? What are my threats? You have to do a SWOT analysis of your entire business opportunities in the market, right? And strategy workforce planning will help you do all of that. And some more indicators again here, right? Competition landscape, market influencers. Pandemic is a market influencer, right? It influenced a lot of the market differently. So you'll have to look at all that business strategy, which is year on year. Once you do that, then you start to understand what talent is required to meet your business strategy for this year, and also keeping in mind your organization goals for the next 3 to 5 years, right? So once you, and when you say business-wise, you could have large divisions or you could have smaller divisions, right? But you typically break that down into smaller divisions, right? A smaller team of, or a smaller team of about 100, 150 people, which you can deep dive and get a little bit more deeper. And again, the reason I'll tell you why in the next slide again. Where you'll have to understand smaller sections a lot more deeply, every talent a lot more deeply. And when you do that, in that process, you try to understand what are the current skills of the people, what is their current capability, what level are they delivering at, and what is your talent mix basically, right? What skills, what people, what, and in the workforce management, we call it skill, will, task, and time. So do we have the right skill? Are our people motivated enough, which is where the will? Do we have the clarity of task that needs to be performed, which goes to the overall goal? And then do they have the right amount of time? Has it been planned properly to have right amount of time to be able to deliver, right? You do all that in the talent need analysis in comparison to your business strategy, which maps onto your organization goals. Once you do that, then as a strategic workforce planning function, you typically have three large channels to do fulfillment, which is what you see on the right-hand side, right? Build, borrow, and buy, which is very simple to understand. Build is, you're trying to build a talent that needs to your business capabilities. Now, every company will have a very unique way of needing talent, right? They need unique perspectives. That's how the business is. So a lot of organization focuses towards building talent. That's where campus people come, people like you who are fresh out of college, right? You all can be molded to what a particular company needs. And that becomes a huge investment for the organization. It becomes a huge channel for every organization to look at. That's why you see in the IT sector and almost all other industries, right? You see a continuous intake of fresh talent coming in, because this is the talent that can get molded to the organization. There is no unlearning, right? There's only learning for them. That's the build strategy. You try and build largely across. A part of the build strategy is also succession planning, where at leadership levels, you identify one levels lower or two levels lower, you identify good performers, and then try and see what you can do to them so that they can become successors for the leadership roles in 12, 18, 24 months time, whichever works for that resource, right? So that's where you build talent. You build talent at the junior pyramid, you also build leadership talent within your company. Then there is a whole borrow strategy. Borrow strategy is some part of your business. You might come up with a thought that, hey, I don't think I need this talent for a long period of time. I don't need this talent permanently. I just need this talent to manage my transition of business from one to the other, right? I'll give you an example. In our automotive business, right, we are more a brick and mortar business. We have huge offices and manufacturing setups and all that stuff. We are now trying to move away from large brick and mortar to a more online digital based work. So I'm looking to hire a consultant who can help me move my digital strategy for my brick and mortar business, right? I don't need this transformation consultant for the next 20 years. I need him for a 6-month, 12-month period time to help me define that strategy, get that strategy understood by people so that he can move on and people can execute. So that's where you get in temporary workforce. And temporary workforce today can come in through multiple formats. I've just given you two or three examples, right? Contingent workforce, which are just temporary workers. You have a whole gig economy. I'm sure you've heard of this, where people work on freelance. They're all specialists. They know deeply one particular area. You can engage with them. Like I said, I want a transformation, a digital transformation consultant. I will go into the market and see who's available, who's a digital transformation consultant expert. I will just tell this person saying, hey, can you come and do this work for me? How long do you require? You need 6 months to do it. Let's get onto a contract and get things on, right? It's purely gig economy. And they could be working on similar such contracts with other people as well. Or if you're working on IPs, right, intellectual property, very sensitive stuff and all that, you could take them on as fixed-term employees. What is fixed-term employees? You have a clear start date, you have a clear end date. And then even the employee knows that, right? Employer knows that. And you have a clear goals written and you're able to do that, right? So that's all the borrow strategy come across. Buy strategy is very simply, largely talent acquisition, right? Which is just recruitment from market. You need experienced resources to come in now immediately with that skill and start delivering to your engagement, start delivering to your projects, start delivering to your business. Then lateral talent acquisition comes in across. And as part of buy strategy, some companies look at mergers and acquisitions or partnerships that you engage into to be able to get that capability, get access to the talent so you can jointly go to the market or build partnerships, build products that request the market. That's where your workforce fulfillment comes, right? And you can apply this build, buy, and borrow strategy either to your existing talent, right? All your current talent across and to the new talent that you'll be requiring across, whether the new talent comes in from campuses, colleges, or it comes in from gig economy, or it comes in from the lateral market where you're heading in push talent across. Once you do this, then you will be able to establish to say, here is my organization goals. Here is my year one, year two, year three, or year four business strategy. And for these individual years, here is my talent needs based on where I am today. Right? You'll have to do an analysis. Again, in the next slide, you will see what are the stages of doing it. Once you are able to understand the as is and the to be skills that is required, then workforce planning team builds this strategy across. How many of, what is your build channel contribution to the overall business strategy and talent needs? What's your borrow stream contribution? What is your buy channel contribution to the overall? That's where workforce planning does. Once it is done, then I'm sure you'll understand in these things, right? It goes to the respective functions, right? Campus recruiting team takes up the campus recruiting job. Performance management team takes up succession planning, right? They also take up performance evaluation of the entire team, right? Resource management team takes up skill competency analysis. Do we have the right skills? What level, what competencies are there and what gaps are required so that they can work with learning and development team to build the skills across. Talent acquisition team gets a clear idea of what they need to hire from the market. Mergers and acquisition team gets an idea of, hey, what do I, if I have to look for a merger or if I have to look for acquiring a company, what capability do I need? What kind of talent do I need? And they can go and look at that kind of mergers and acquisitions or that kind of partnership across. So every function will get clear direction in terms of what they need to do and how are they contributing to the overall business strategy, right? I'll take a quick pause in here, see if there are any thoughts, any discussion points you want to bring up before we go to the next slide, because the next slide is a level lower on how strategy workforce planning is done. There are questions, we can move on. Maybe we can questions, we'll take, see if we can take questions in the evening after this thing, right? So there are six important stages of workforce planning, right? And if you look at the entire six stages, right, it answers the question saying, where do you start and how do you govern? There is no stop if you keep that, if you realize that by now. There is no stop in strategy workforce planning. It's where you start and how do you have a governance mechanism that ensures that you're continuously aligned, right? The bold blue ones are the six important stages, which we can look at. I know this is a very busy slide, but we'll spend a little bit more deeper time onto this, right? Like we talked about on earlier slide, articulating the business strategy by the leadership is very important. They have to articulate the business strategy in two terms. One is the business knowledge, like in terms of financial numbers or profitability or market share or whatever it is. But it is also as strategic workforce planning people, we will have to help the leaders translate that to human capital. Try and talk something related to human people. Say, I need this kind of person. Or in the future, I'm looking at these people. So I need people with these skills and capabilities. Or these are what my current clients are saying. Or this is what the market is demanding. Try and relate all of that business strategy that they're articulating to some form. Believe me, it is never easy for a CEO or for a board of directors to go back and talk that language. It's very difficult for them. And that is where we'll have to, when you allow them to talk the business strategy, then you also lead their thoughts around how do they see the current talent in them, so they can give you some idea of what the talent is. And 99 out of 10 times I'll give you that the need for talent that they will tell you is more from what the clients are saying or what the market is saying. They will have, I mean, at the board level, they will have little information of what the internal talent are. And that is the talent acquisition, I mean, the strategy workforce planning's job. That's our job, to have internal talent availability, skill capability information, look at what the business leaders are saying, and it's our job to match both together. So one is articulating business strategy. Once you have business strategy, then it's the strategic workforce planning's job to model the talent for the future. What is the talent and the skills that is required? We talked about a simple example of marketing, right? Over a long period of time. It need not even be that period of time, right? We're talking about a 3-year time. What is the role today? Let's say, what is a marketing person doing today? And what will the marketing person do, let's say, 3 years from now? We're talking about newer technologies like artificial intelligence and machine learning and Internet of Things and blockchain and all that stuff. How all of these things are going to impact a particular role? How is the business moving? We see consumer, if you're in a consumer services industry, consumer behavior is moving. What kind of skills is required to ensure that I have the people who can take care of my consumer behavior 3 years from now? Where do you expect them to be? So the strategic workforce planning team looks at building a model that is, that they say that, hey, if you have this composition of skill mix and capability mix, you are ready for the future. Right? And you will be ready for the future when the future comes in that point in time. So that's the modeling work that you'll have to take, which requires a lot of intelligence, market intelligence, analysis between, you know, access to 2B, skill competency frameworks. There's so much of things that we'll have to do to understand, to build that model. Once you build that model, then, like I said, as strategy workforce planning or your HR business partnering team or your performance management team, your learning and development team, all of us has to get together to analyze what is the gap between what skills I need for the future versus what do I have today, right? And you'll have to do this at the level of every employee in the organization. Even if you're a 100,000 member organization or a 200,000 member organization, you'll have to do it at that level. Otherwise, it will start falling through the cracks, right? And that's the, I would say that's the epicenter of workforce planning, where you understand the gap between what is needed 3-5 years from now versus what is today. Once you do that, you also, by virtue of that, you also understand the supply channel, right? Which is how much of it is internal, how much of it is external, and from external, the build, buy, and borrow, and all that stuff, right? So you'll do gap analysis and you'll do talent supply, the 3 and 4 stage together combined, right? I've just called it out because it's important to understand supply markets and the gap supply, right? Once you do that, this is where workforce planning truly brings in all the functions together. You identify and develop plans to remediate talent gaps. What do you mean by that? Your build, buy, and borrow strategy. And in all of that, you're going to give clear instructions or clear directions, goals to individual functions. What does Total Rewards need to do for the skills of the future? How can they have the best in class Total Rewards program? What is the performance management system that we need to have for a new skill? The current performance management system may or may not work. Well, how do we need to do that? What should be a performance evaluation criteria? What should be our career paths, right? HR business partners will be now looking at what should be my new engagement plans to retain talent. And what should I do differently from what I'm doing in today? So every function will get a goal that ultimately backs my business strategy, but then strategy workforce planning is trying to bring all of those people together to be able to look at how the talent is transformed to the future starting from today, right? And once you do that, then it's the strategic workforce planning team responsibility to bring all these people together, right? We act as the glue or the binders of all these functions together. Is where you have a clear governance mechanism, right? You implement the workforce plan, but you also monitor an impact, right? And you continuously remediate. And here is what you'll have to understand. When you're doing a governance mechanism, you will have to always have the governance mechanism to a reference framework. The reference framework for us is always a business strategy, right? So when we are defining a monitoring or governance mechanism, you also have an eye on how the business strategy has changed, right? We started off on this business strategy maybe 6 months ago. And we did all this activity. It will take 6 months or maybe even longer, depending on the maturity of the organization. But by the time you get to stage 5, we also have to understand that, A, what we did in stage 1, is it still relevant? Is the business strategy still relevant? Or has business strategy changed? If it has changed, then now what tweaks do I need to do to ensure that all the execution plans of the individual organizations are now aligned to the revised business strategy? And that's where the governance and the monitoring framework comes in. And that's why I said, strategy workforce planning starts with articulating business strategy. But there is no stop to it, because then you get into a governance mode, right? Think of it as an autopilot mode, but you still need a pilot to sit there and figure out if all the readings are number right. even though the plane is in cruise mode or whatever, right? You still need a pilot to sit there and see if all the readings are right. And if it is not, then the pilot has to take control of the flight, right? And autopilot doesn't work anymore. Likewise, strategic workforce planning has to ensure that while you try to put it on autopilot mode, you will have to sit there and govern and ensure that everybody is doing under it, right? Then that's where the strategic workforce planning truly enables the business to grow in all of these things. What is now, I'm sure it's easy to understand, is when you get every function to work in a way that it's all aligned to a larger strategy, what it happens to employees, and remember on slide one, right? All the challenges we talked about, low morale, low productivity, skill is a problem, attrition is there. All of these problems, you will have a solution because your workforce planning ensures that the right person is there in the right place with the right skills at the right time and cost, which is the future, right? When you have that kind of a person doing the job, then all the other problems goes away, right? You don't have to worry about high funder retention programs. You don't have to pay higher cost to retain this talent, right? The skills are absolutely right, which means they can't be, the quality of work or the customer experience will be much better. You have the right person doing the right job, which means the person is not feeling burnout or his morale is not low because he doesn't want to or doesn't like doing the job, but he's being forced to do it. Those don't exist because in your plans, you're trying to put a right person, the right skill, to the right job. And when you do that, a lot of the other HR problems or the so-called HR problems that the organization solves tries to go away, right? I'm not saying it'll get completely reduced, but it helps in reducing that to a greater extent because you're giving clarity. By virtue of giving clarity to individual departments, you're giving showing that every, as an employee, you are giving clarity to that person in terms of what they're doing, why they're doing that. And you will have a review mechanism to know whether the person likes the job or doesn't like the job. And if you don't, then you can work through rotation mechanisms and all that stuff. End of the day, it ensures that you have the right person in the job doing it, right? I'll give you a quick idea of what the governance frameworks that I have implemented in one of the organizations, right? This is how the execution works. And typically, this is something that I give it to the workforce management organization or the resource management organization, not something that a strategic workforce planning does. But we have, they are like our extended arms and then they take care of meeting our objectives, meeting our goals, right? Where we set the goals and directive and the strategy and direction, all that stuff, right? But when we talk all of these things to organization, right? When we are starting, it's not a green field, we're starting from scratch. Typically, you'll have most organizations thinking, where do I start from? The start could be very simple. What is your talent needs? What is your today's talent needs? Tell me your talent needs for today. Tell me your talent needs for, let's say, 1 year from now or 2 years from now. Why do you need those demands? So you capture the business demands. You understand the short and long-term implications of the demand. What is the strategy of the demand? Why do you need that skill across? And then once you're able to understand that, which means you're trying to do step 2, 3, and 4, as per the earlier slide, right? Together, when you try to understand the demand in terms of its short, long-term impact to the business organization, that is where you're doing the analysis part and the skill gap analysis part. And then when you analyze the gaps, then you can look at how you want to fill the gap. You want to fill the gap through build, buy, or borrow, right? And the build could be that you have a demand or you have a position opened up. Somebody in the organization is putting up a hand and saying, hey, I want to take on this new role. But how do you know the person can do the new role? Does he have the right skills? Does he have the right scale, will, task, and time to do the job? If not, the person might still be there, but then you can build some of these things or you can fill the gap by doing some customized training programs or rescaling programs or whatever it is, right? To be able to person take on new role. So when you start doing that at an employee level, then you're ensuring that the right employees are getting onto the right roles, right? And you have the right channel that is across. You know when to evoke build, you will know when to evoke buy, and you know when to evoke borrow. And not that when a demand comes in and we're trying to go business, not that every channel is engaged and you're blindly throwing. It's not like a game of dart that you throw a stick and you hope to hit the bullseye. That's not what we're doing. We're trying to see that every opportunity that the business has got to grow has got a clear strategy and an approach to say how the business will go, right? And that's where the governance execution framework comes in. So that's all I had. I'll take a stop in here. I want to keep it at a high level so that you understand the concepts, right? When you start getting into execution, there are just so many things. And today, I'll just leave you with one small thing, which you have already heard of. In strategic workforce planning, what we are now challenged with is how a hybrid workforce will be still able to meet all of these business goals. Now, keep in mind, all of these things, we thought that the people will be co-located, they will be face-to-face each other, that people will come into office, they have access to physical training programs, we know what their employees are doing, or the managers see what the employees are doing and they're able to judge and all that. Now, all that has gone out of the window in the last 1.5 years. Now, if everybody is working remote, or there is a hybrid, going to be a hybrid team, that some employees will work remote, some employees may come to office at some point in time, some employees will come office a lot more regularly. And as a manager or as a leader, you will have a hybrid team of all these people. How do you ensure that the business is able to still perform? And that is where they've come to strategy workforce planning and said, hey, if I'm going to have a very hybrid resource model, how does the entire framework change, governance or the execution framework change, for me to support a hybrid model of engagement with my employees? And that's a very interesting challenge that we have in front of us. Not that we have a solution today. Individual companies are trying to solve it in their own ways, but that's the, how do I say, that's the new kid on the block that we're trying to see how we can cope up with that challenge. So I'll take a pause in here. Like I said, it's I want to leave you with the concepts. Let me try and see if there are any questions, thoughts that you want to bring it up.
Participants, if you have any questions, kindly unmute yourself and ask the questions, or you can post it in the chat box.
Should we assume people are still thinking, or there are no questions?
Sir?
Yes, please.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, my question is, you told that there is no end to the succession planning process.
That is like not it, strategic planning process.
Yes, sir. You told that it goes on in a rotation process. Can't we have, can we not have this as a stop? If we have found a person for the right, if we have found the right person for the right job at the right time with specific skills, is it not end for that position, sir?
You can look at it at a transaction level. You can look at it. If you look at it at a transaction level, it might sound like it's a logical stop for that activity, right? But again, keep in mind, strategic workforce planning doesn't operate at the transaction level. Strategic workforce planning is not about, I have a position open and somebody came in and then the position is closed. That's a resource management's job. Strategic workforce planning is to ensure that I needed a particular skill mix. I needed a particular, let's say, size mix, location mix, for 3 years from now for my business to grow, right? And this is keeping in mind a particular business strategy that was articulated in the start of the year. Now, if the business strategy has changed, or one, it's relevant and it's changed, it will change, right? No business strategy will remain as is for the entire 3 years. It will change. Strategic workforce planning operates at that level, doesn't operate at a transaction level. It continuously works with the leaders and the business leaders to ensure what is the business that has changed. Like I said, I gave you an example of pandemic, right? When people made their business plans in February 2020 or March of 2020, their plans would have been very different, and it will be forcibly changed when the pandemic started hitting in and people came work from homes and the consumer stopped spending, or there were a lot of other restrictions and all that stuff. The entire business plans changed. Now, the business leader's first stop shop is to go to the strategic workforce planning team and say, hey, my entire business has changed. How are you changing your human capital plans that ensure that it meets my needs of the business now? And you operate at that level. It's not about opening a demand and all that stuff, right? One of the opportunities of strategic workforce planning could be succession planning, right? It's a, hey, this person I had to let go for a different reason, or is going for a different reason. Do you have somebody who can step into that shoes? Then as strategic workforce planning team, you go to the performance management team, or maybe if you have a separate succession planning team or leadership potential team, you can ask them saying, hey, what is your strategy, or what is your approach, or what is your pipeline that you have generated to fill the shoes that somebody is moving, right? And that's where strategic workforce planning team integrates multiple functions across. So this function sits at the strategy level, doesn't get down to the execution level. I hope I was able to answer your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
It was another question on the chat, right? I was just seeing that message in here. How is succession planning different from workforce planning? Workforce is a much broader concept. Succession is a subset of it, right? It's one of the components. Now, succession planning, performance management, promotions, even at all levels across, upskilling, cross-skilling, all of that are outputs of workforce planning. When you say workforce, it's something that it's a strategy and an approach that constitutes to the entire company. Whether you are a 100 member company or a 100,000 member company, it doesn't matter. It's a strategy that operates across every employee. Succession planning, some organizations will identify only to leadership positions. Some organizations will identify only to high potential performers. Hey, this person is a high potential. I also have a risk of him leaving. Do I have a succession planning in place so that if tomorrow the person leaves, I have another high potential taking over his place? So that's how it works. I'm hoping I was able to give you the difference between succession planning and workforce planning. Right. The other question that is there are job functions and competencies changing? Oh, absolutely. I mean, there is just no doubt that the competencies have changed. I mean, not changing. They have already changed a lot from what it was in March 2020 to what it is today, right? The competencies have changed very differently. And I'm not even talking about technical competencies. That is, in my opinion, let's say bullet point two. The bullet point one is functional or behavioral competencies. Are people able to work remotely? Do they have enough skills on the technology that isn't there to be able to do their work across, right? Does managers have remote managing capabilities? Now, like I said, they're all used to seeing the team members in front of them, maybe 6, 7, 8 hours a day and all that stuff. Do managers know how to manage team members remotely? Are they able to understand what stress the employees are going in through? Are they struggling through the work, not struggling through the work? So the entire employee management has gone live. HR business partnering has they were doing events and all that stuff to do engagement. Now all of that has gone virtual. Are HRBPs equipped to run engagement programs virtual? Our retention programs can be run virtual. How do you ensure employee connect? So the competencies have changed and it's continuously changing. Like I said, it's again changing now when there is a hybrid workforce coming in. So yes, it's changed. And that's the whole place where strategic workforce planning comes in to see what is the skills now required for every role. And how do I ensure that the organization have, even in our own function, when we used to strategy workforce planning phasing, right? It's like a board meeting. We'll call the CEO, we'll call the CFO, we'll call the CIO and the strategy officer. They're all sitting together in a room. We work and we run this as a workshop for 6, 7 hours. We have focused attention and all that stuff. Imagine running that setup in a Google Meet like this. It's so easy for somebody to switch off to another window and do something else and not concentrate. And if they don't do that, then we won't get quality inputs or quality outputs out of that meeting. So how can you hold people's attention for a longer period of time, trying to do a workshop and trying to do the same strategic objectives that you were doing earlier? Skills and competencies have changed. And that is what is required right now. Even now, I'm trying to adapt saying, how can I do virtual board meetings, virtual, workshops where we can define strategy and define execution framework to the strategy. That's where we come in across, right? Define programs. So yes, it's changed a lot and it will continue to change for another year or so before you start to see some kind of stability in it, because by that time it would have stabilized and work settled around. And then you can figure out what skill upgradation programs as you as an individual need to take it through to be able to sustain in the new world. What skill set do we need for meaning planning effective, right? See, there's a lot of skills that is required. One, in a strategic workforce planning team, I'm assuming that question is to what skills is required if you want to be a part of the planning organization, right? Or planning to be effective. One of the most important skills is your ability to understand business and talent. It's a very unique combination, right? People either understand one or the other, but not both. But if you want to be a good planning person, you have to understand both ends of the world or both sides of the coin. That's one. You should have excellent analytical skills, right? To be able to analyze various data information across and make a logical conclusion out of it, right? Make a conclusion that's logical. Third, you should have some bit of analytical skills because you have to test all that logic using data and say, hey, this works across, right? And the other way is, I mean, the other most important thing is when you do all of that, when you do modeling and all that stuff, you should be able to go and stand in front of the executive leadership and present. So your presentation skills, your ability to articulate your thoughts and your entire strategy becomes very important. When a person has these skills and is doing a planning job, you get a feeling that the planning is more wholesome. It's been well thought through. It's got good connections. It's got a roadmap and it's got grounded roots as well, right? And that's where you will get buy-in from the leadership to subscribe to your plan. Otherwise, you'll have a lot of debates going on and all that stuff. It won't typically help. Those are the 3-4 qualities that will require, that will make a person good planning person. I'm hoping again, it answers your question, Megha. The other question that's come up is, as HR, what additional skills and technology one should learn to adapt to the current situation? I think we have to get a lot more digitally savvy and we have to understand what these technologies are impacting, right? We heard a lot about artificial intelligence and machine learning. Like I said, robotic process automation, you have blockchain, you have IoT. You have so many of these things coming up day in and day out, right? And it's important for HR for us to understand what these technologies are, how these technologies can come in and help us do our jobs much better, right? For example, I'll give you an example in strategy workforce planning. We use blockchain a lot. Now, blockchain is something that you will have heard, you've not heard a use case in strategy workforce planning. But we use blockchain to identify patterns of change that happens in the data. So when you have a company's performance data over the last 5 years, so the last 7 years, that is 7 to 12, 84 months of data that we have in terms of various performance, right? Employee performance, business performance, financial performance, a lot of those things. We actually employ algorithms of blockchain to identify patterns as to what are the inflection points in the business, and for those inflection points, whether the inflection happened in the right sense or wrong sense, and how is talent looking at coming in. So you need to have a good understanding of how technology can help you do your job better. First way to do that is for you to understand what these technologies are, what these concepts are, and how it can help you do your job better. Right? You don't want to, I mean, as HR professionals, we're not going to sit and code or write algorithms or write programs, all that stuff. That's not the job. But you should know what these technologies to be used where. I mean, like I said, where you have to know where to use blockchain, where to use machine learning, where to use IoT to be able to get things done. And some companies, I'll tell you, some of my friends are using IoT as an employee engagement. Right? They have some end system triggered installed in every employee's laptop. When they run an engagement program, that end system, which is like an IoT device, captures some feedback and go back and tells them whether the employee is engaged, not engaged, and all that stuff. So you have to know where to use those technologies. And that's where you probably become a good HR person. Okay, there's another one that's come in. People are changing their company every year, especially IT. How do you see this? And how do you see this growth from your perspective? Is it good in terms of career growth, or will it be a distraction? See, when somebody is looking to jump ship every year, there is enough data to prove that their learning has been the lowest, right? If not the absolute bottom, right? You have an opportunity to learn to contribute more when you have more stable environment, right? When you have deeper knowledge of the environment, when you have deeper knowledge of the business, right? Put yourself in your own life situation. Forget office for a minute. Any life situation. If you are not comfortable doing it, you typically hesitate to do it, or you don't do a good job of it, right? It could be anything. Let's say you're learning to drive a car for the first time, or you're driving a bike for the first time. The first couple of weeks you're driving, you're never confident, right? Hands are shaky, wheels are shaking. You know, when somebody honks, you're not comfortable and all that stuff, right? You have to get comfortable. When you start driving for 2-3 weeks, then you get a little bit more comfortable, right? Why is that? Because when you continuously do things repeatedly and you're in an environment that is comfortable to you, you start applying and you start learning more. Your brain is tuned to learn that way more. Every time when you change your environment, right? Let's say today you drive a different two-wheeler, tomorrow you're a different two-wheeler, third day you drive a car, fourth day you drive something else. You won't have familiarity of what's going on. And every time you need some time to learn, right? To learn to be able to contribute. When people are changing their jobs so frequently, we have seen that their learning capability, if you want to put it right, their learning capability is the lowest. And it's going to impact them in the long run. It might be beneficial, let's say economically or financially, the first 2-3 years or maybe even 5 years. But after that, it's going to land them in trouble because their ability to learn is completely gassed. In fact, they only have ability to adapt. I mean, which is a good thing. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. But ability to adapt is ability to survive. Ability to learn is where ability to grow comes. That's how the factors correlate. Again, I hope Prasanna, I was able to answer your question.
Sir, hi. Sir.
Hi, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yes, sir. This is Fasmin, and I'm from First MHRM. Sir, you were speaking about the importance of planning and all of that. And you were also telling that the situation now, or the times right now, are ever changing. The one major part or one essential part of planning is forecasting.
Yes.
How do you forecast in such, you know, unstable environment?
See, when you do planning at a macro level. You don't do planning at a micro level, right? The changes that happens at the micro level cannot impact too much. It will impact you in the long run. And that is where the ability to forecast comes. For example, let me take a simple role as example. Right? It is all HRs. Today, we are learning to become virtually savvy, if you want me to call it, right? All of the HR initiatives are going on virtual programs, right? On digital programs and all that stuff, right? Now, that's what we are learning in today. What I'm trying to build for an HR VP for the future is I want to be able to visualize a situation that, let's say as an engagement, as an HR business partner, your role today is to run 10 engagement programs. And your end result is that my employee satisfaction score or my productivity scores for an employee goes up, right? That's what is the role of HRBP today. Now, what we are modeling for is, instead of an HRBP executing these programs, which is what most HRBPs today, 3 years from now, I will be assuming that there will be enough technology, enough innovation that is happening in, that ensures that once I'm able to conceptualize a program, the technology system or the technology ecosystem will be able to implement it much better than what a human being will ever implement. So that's my forecast. My forecast is going to say my HRBP roles are no more longer going to be execution focused. They are going to be solution focused. They have to come up and think solutions. And that's where my HRBP is going to be 3 years from now. Now, if that's the plan and that's the forecasting that I'm looking to do, we are looking at, and I know today that the technology is continuously changing. It is going to change to a situation that we will have better technologies in the future for HR jobs. If that's the case, then my second question is, are my HRBPs today, do they have capability, the skill, the will, the task, and the time to be able to conceptualize solutions that are needed for the business? Because their job in the future will be to conceptualize solutions, find solutions to problems, not run executions, right? Somebody's already thought to the solution, somebody wants to run it. Because running or implementing a solution could be done on a technology platform or could be done through different ways, right? That's where the change comes. Today, our technology is changing, but we're not worried about today. We are saying that HRBPs needs to have capability to move away from execution to more conceptualizing, to more problem solving, rather than execution of a problem solving. That's how you plan at the strategy level. Today, things will change. And then you will have to, the trick is, and that's where a little bit of experience and a market correlation and all that stuff come into place, right? And you need a lot of forums to be part of. You need to be able to relatively forecast the future. And you'll be able to do that only have a lot of data, intelligence, and market connection of what's going on. Likewise, today, like I said, right, somebody let's say an organization thought that marketing will be more online, will be more digital, will be more virtual. 5 years from now, let's say they thought that in 2010 and 2015, they start doing it. If they were preparing for it, then they would have ensured that their marketing people are trained to be able to do digital marketing, to be able to do social media marketing, to be able to do brand building and all that stuff. Let's say organization did not forecast that or did not do that. Then their marketing people are not able to do that, right? And those are the kind of people who probably got laid off when the pandemic started and people left laid off because they thought, hey, as an organization, we were not ready to do marketing online or brand management online or whatever, right? And we were not able to do that. So what will this person sitting at home do? Nothing for me. And hence they thought it's better to lay off the person and save cost versus an organization is able to plan for the future. That's the difference in planning and forecasting. Right. You will have to be able to fairly accurately forecast the future, keeping in mind that today there will be those incremental changes. And the challenge is that those incremental changes are leading to something. It's your job to see where it will land 3 years from now. Does that make sense, Vasant?
Yes, sir, it does. So I also understood that it is very important for us to understand the other functions of the organization to be able to enable them better.
Yes, that's the HR's job, right? HR is a business enabler. No longer, you know, those days are gone where HR is called as a support function. No, we are enablers of business. So it is our job to understand business, and it means business. We're talking about every single function in the organization, every single department in the organization. We will have to know them threadbare so that our job is to figure out solutions for those individual organizations that correctively enables business. That's okay, HR's job.
Very beautifully put. Thank you so much.
Welcome, Pat. Okay, I'm going to be a little conscious of time. I know we have 4 minutes past the scheduled time of 7, so or 4 or 5 minutes. Feel free to I'll let one of these coordinators consolidate for the questions, and one of them can reach back to me. I'll be more than happy to share my thoughts on email or on written document to be able to for you to answer more questions. Be happy to do that. But again, just being a little conscious of time because it's Saturday evening, I'm sure you've got your other work to take care of and other social events to attend to.
Sir, I don't think we have any more questions. Can we move on to the vote of thanks, sir?
Absolutely.
I would now like to call upon Ms. Sushmita of final year MHRM to render the vote of thanks.
Before you're a leader, success is all about growing yourself. When you become a leader, success is all about growing others. I, Sushmita of second MHRM, take this wonderful opportunity to thank our esteemed speaker, Mr. Narayanan Ramachandran, Director, Global Talent Acquisition and Strategic Workforce Planning in Abdul Latif Jameel. I thank our esteemed speaker for sharing his valuable insights and knowledge on the topic strategic workforce planning. I would like to share a few key takeaways from today's session, where strategic workforce planning states that company has the right people in the right place with the right skills at the right time or cost and with the right level of flexibility. A structured approach would consider 3 to 5 years perspective to build the workforce needs. As planning is done, it is done at the micro level. Strategic workforce planning acts as a glue to bring all the strategies together for governance mechanisms. So we, the future HRs, would really work on the understandings provided by our lively speaker. And as sharing is caring is an age-old proverb, to this thought, I would like to thank the pillar of our PG Department of HRM, our HRE, Dr. N.C. Martin, for sharing this, arranging this webinar, and Professor Snega for her support to organize this webinar, providing us with an enlightening tour to the pragmatic arena of HR. Finally, I extend my gratitude to participants from various professions and students. So kindly fill up the feedback form, which is provided in the chat below, with your name and email ID. Stay home, stay safe. Thank you all. Have a great evening. And once again, thank you so much for such an amazing and wonderful session. So thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Have a great evening. Take care. Stay safe. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.